This is a bite that I made. And if you don't know what a bite is, it's just a 6-second long looping video. And this year, I've made quite a lot of them.
You're a literal baby and a figurative baby. Oh! You're
Now, that wasn't one of mine, but it might feel familiar. That's because Bite has the same team as Vine, the same gimmick, and a handful of the same Viners. So if you're scrolling through Bite, you can expect to find mostly the same type of skits that were once popular in 2016. This isn't exactly the creator's fault though. It's everything to do with the limitations that come with very, very short form content. Take for example making a character. A drama needs a character that we can empathize with, while a joke doesn't. And in 6 seconds, which sounds easier to do? So I knew there would be problems, but that didn't exactly put me off trying to write a story for Bite. It's fine, my story's simple. There's a TV that is constantly looping between 5 locations in the main character's house with no evidence of any cameras, and there's this blue panel that's warping the world around it, which could be related to a girl without a face. Okay, it could be simpler. Don't worry though, this video isn't about that. It's about the problems that I ran headfirst into while trying to make a story this way. Like, how are you meant to develop a character when you're severely limited on dialogue? What happens to pacing when things have to happen so quickly? It just doesn't feel like a story can work with this much strain put on it, and this was a story that used multiple 6-second clips. What about stories that don't have that privilege? Stories that only have seconds at their disposal? It seems like the rules that screenwriting gurus write down in their screenplay bibles just aren't compatible with very short form content. The space needed to implement any of their golden rules and structures don't exist. And for someone like me, who's been getting increasingly frustrated with the rules of storytelling and how restricting they feel, this felt kinda good. I found myself really wanting to learn more about the atomic levels of storytelling. That's not all though. This video is about the creation of the shortest narrative film. So, did you catch that? That is one of the many self-described shortest films, and in order to make one of our own, we'll have to know a bit more about it. It's called the hashtag leap second movie : the world's shortest short film. And true to its name, it was made for the leap year in order to show everyone the value of a second. And the creator does this by cramming a family photo into every single frame. There certainly is a sentiment there, but I don't feel like it tells a story. Let me explain. Iceberg storytelling is a way of leaving intentional gaps in your story that you trust your audience to fill. You show the top of the iceberg and the audience guesses at what's underneath the water. Hemingway's famous short story is a useful example here. It goes, "For sale, baby shoes, never worn." Through 6 words, we can infer the existence of 2 characters, which are the parents, a tragedy, and a resolution of sorts. This story bleeds into both the future and the past. The hashtag leap second movie, on the other hand, doesn't have the same sense of progression to it. You can argue that it does technically have characters, but there's no way for us to know how they got where they are, or where they're likely to go next. Could you write a shorter story than Hemingway's? Possibly. However, it becomes increasingly more difficult to leave clues for the reader, to guide them towards the story. Here's an example. Could the word death be a short story? Every single person must have at least a thought or two about death rattling around in their head. Maybe you think of a family pet. Maybe you think of an air conditioner detaching itself from a building and crushing you. Maybe you think of the color black. As you can see, there's no structure to it. Theoretically, every single person could be thinking of something different. And isn't that a problem? Just because you can trigger someone's imagination doesn't mean that what you're doing is storytelling. With just a single word, the writer can't possibly direct their reader to think of things in a structured way. And so, no story can take place. Film is a different medium though. Maybe it can relay more in a shorter amount of time because of its visual nature. Let's put that to the test. Can a short film be just one frame? A single frame would lack most of the things that make a film, mainly the movement. It can still tell a story though. A good example of this is Annie Leibovitz's photo of a bicycle, which bleeds into the past and gives us a good idea of what might come next. However, without audio and movement, it can't be classified as a film exactly. Mertz says it best. Going from one image to two images is to go from image to language. And there is a relevant example that comes to mind of just two frames telling a story. In 1919, during the height of the Spanish flu, Edward Munch painted a portrait titled Self-Portrait with the Spanish Flu. It's a haunting portrait. Munch's face is almost indistinguishable from the colours of the background. It seems timeless, stuffy. That same year he released the second frame, Self-Portrait after Spanish Flu, and we can see his face again. It may be a bit haggard, but it's there. Munch's portraits tell a story. They have a sense of progression, an overcoming of conflict. But they are paintings. We can soak them in for as long as we want. If you were to use them as your two frames, squashed together with no room to breathe, there'd be no time to appreciate them as they flip by in 1/12th of a second. Maybe these two paintings just aren't right for this two-frame format. But that doesn't mean that there aren't two frames out there that could work. My roommate thinks he knows what those frames are. My roommate is a strong believer in the two-frame claim. The claim that the shortest film is just two frames long.
Are you dead?
Yeah.
And his idea for a two-frame story is simple. Put a man with a gun in the first frame and a dead body in the second. And you've told a story in just two frames. This doesn't seem intuitive to me, but maybe he's right. These frames build off of imagery of murder that we've seen in countless films, so it's easily recognizable for a viewer. It uses strong shapes and colours for ease of understanding, and there's also definitely a sequence of events happening that we're right in the middle of. But would a viewer really be able to understand this story? Were you able to? And this is the question that I've been stuck on for 2 whole months now. And that might seem weird because, as we both know, the brain can process imagery in as little as 13 milliseconds, which is just under a frame in 60 frames per second, which means that yes, Man with Gun would be the shortest possible film we can make. But that isn't the answer I was looking for. I was looking to prove something else. I wanted to prove that the normal rules of storytelling don't work for extremely short films. Let me explain why I believe that in the first place. I noticed that something strange happens to story structure when it's put under time pressure. For a normal 30-minute long short film, it's easy to include a setup, a conflict, and a resolution. You can't exactly do that for a short film that dips below 1 minute. For that short film, you have to do something different. You have to use the format of a joke, which has a setup and a punchline. Take for example the short Bambi Meets Godzilla. This short does two very interesting things. Firstly, the brunt of the setup doesn't happen inside the short, but rather in the title. We know from the title that Godzilla is going to meet Bambi, and the punchline comes when we find out what exactly that meeting entails. A much flatter Bambi. It's a simple subversion of expectations, but everything we need is wrapped up in a neat package. I thought that the other parts of storytelling would also be affected by this time pressure, but that doesn't seem to be the case. For example, there always seems to be space for a character. And that should have been very, very obvious from every single painting that includes a character. It seems like structure is the exception here. That doesn't seem to upset me as much as I thought it would, though. And I think I know why. I shouldn't have waged war on the rules of storytelling, but instead on the people writing about them. Sid Field, McKee, Writer's Journey, Save the Cat, 7 Basic Plots, making short films. All of these writers don't stop writing once they tell you what a story is. They go on to tell you what a good story should be, which of course is limiting. They also believe that conflict is the driver of a story, and that conflict is very volatile, something that causes bank robberies and murders and divorces. I think that a story can be quieter than that. Through working on this video, I've realized something. There is one thing in common with every single short that I've looked at, and that goes also for abstract short films. That thing is movement or progression. That's all you need for a story. It doesn't need to be more complicated than that. If you're moving through a bunch of incidents connecting characters, then you're telling a story. And you don't have to listen to people who say there's more to it than that. It might just limit the wonderful stories that you might someday tell. Now, let's make this short film with the different things we've learned. Firstly, the most important thing. The short needs to have progression to it, like we just talked about. The action needs to come from somewhere and go someplace else. Even abstract narration works like this, where the sequences are composed of color, space, and shape instead of imagery we can immediately place. Since we're aiming for something very short, we'll have to rely on iceberg storytelling. We'll need to leave clues for the reader that show how this event is connected to others. Another thing that might help is to make sure our use of color, framing, and subject are all geared towards creating an after image in the viewer's mind. This will make sure that somebody won't be able to just glide over it without engaging. A lot of extremely short story writers do something similar to this, where they try and make the wording and grammar interesting, like a crossword clue, so that you're forced to engage in some way to understand it. One of the easiest ways to ensure that an audience understands the short is to use imagery that they are familiar with. And there is imagery that I'm certain everyone watching can easily understand. This is where the clips I've used in this video so far can come into play. We can also use our title to carry some of the meaning of the piece. This could be to give context to the piece, like Self-Portrait with Spanish Flu, or it could be a wind-up for a joke format, like Bambi Meets Godzilla. And as for the time length, I'm aiming to make it under a second so I can beat out the Leap Second movie. Okay, this short is called I Used to Climb Trees. Maybe the world's shortest film. Maybe. Thank you.